I want you to take your Bibles this morning and go with me to the book of James, chapter 1. We just finished a two-part series on why Christians suffer, and I really felt to discuss the character of God, and we'll do that over the next number of weeks. Especially important as we come in this time of Thanksgiving, Christmas, for people to understand what God is like. As many times God gets blamed for things that he has nothing to do with. People say if God is a God of love, then why all the wars and hunger and earthquakes and famines and pestilence? But there's a reason why those things are going on, and it's not God's fault. Verse 12 of chapter 1 said, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And when lust is conceived, it brings forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning." The Amplified says, "Every good gift and every perfect, free, large, and full gift is from above. It comes down from the Father of all that gives light, in the shining of whom there can be no variation, rising or setting, or shadow cast by his turning as in an eclipse." That means God never changes. And I'm here to declare to you today that God is a good God and the devil is a bad devil. We can see that just in the way that he reached out to us. The Bible says, "And while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." And we see the love of God that is extended to us. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And then I love verse 17, "For God did not send his Son to the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." So we see that God's love and grace and mercy is reaching out to a lost and dying world. When you realize this, then you realize that hell was not made for man. Hell was made for the devil and all of his angels. Unfortunately, men are going to go there because of their rejection of God. But I'm here to tell you as well that you don't have to go to devil's hell because of the price that was paid on Calvary 2,000 years ago. Fact of the matter is that God has given every man a free will, and man has that choice to choose. Deuteronomy 30 and verse 19, "I call heaven and earth to record this day against you. I've set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both you and your seed may live. Therefore everyone in this place, under the sound of my voice, can choose life." When you get tired of death, when you get tired of everything that hell has to offer, and then you come into an understanding of the Word of God, of what was purchased for you at Calvary's cross, then suddenly you say, "I'm not taking this anymore." 2,000 years ago, Jesus paid the price. If he paid the price, then what am I trying to do? And I need to read the fine print to find out what was bought and paid for at Calvary's cross, and then I need to stand upon the Word of God and enforce the devil's defeat. Because let me tell you, the devil was defeated at Calvary. 2,000 years ago, the Bible says, "He, having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it." That's your heavenly Father. And when you are born again, then you come into the family of God. You are no longer subject to the lies of the devil and to the wiles of the devil. You don't anymore belong to him. You now belong to God. He is your Father, and he's a good God. And when you obey him and you serve him, then there's nothing the devil can do. He can try all he wants to, but he cannot stop you, for the devil does not control your destiny. God controls your destiny. So all of the good in the world is because of God, and all of the bad in the world is because of the devil. God is not sitting in heaven thinking to himself, what can I do to man today? Let me put sickness on them. Let me destroy them. God, he doesn't even function that way, because you can see that manifest in the person of Jesus Christ. When you go and read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the Bible even says at the end of the Gospel of John, all these miracles that Jesus do and all the others that he've written down, I do not even suppose the books of the world will contain them. And you can read everywhere he went, he healed the sick, he cleansed the leper, he raised the dead, he forgave sin. And Jesus was the express image of the Father. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He said, I and my Father are one. He said, I did not come to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. And so Jesus was a direct representation of the Father. The Father's heart was displayed to the world by Jesus when he came and walked the earth 2,000 years ago. And I'm here to tell you that he is alive and he is living today. And today you can be born again. Today you can be saved. Today you can be translated out of darkness into light. Too many of God's people are identifying with the wrong kingdom. In the world there'll be tribulation. The Bible says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us out of them all. The Bible says there's no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. And God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation make a way of escape. And so you have to know that there's an enemy of your soul. He hates you. He hates the very ground that you walk on. And when you begin to worship God, you took his place. That's why I love that song, said the devil don't like it because he had it one time, but I got it. I got it because that is a fact, that he was worshiping before the throne of God. But because of sin, he was cast out of heaven. And now you and I have taken their place. That's why he hates humanity. That's why he comes against people. He hates people. But God loves people. And he loves people of every tribe and every tongue, no matter what race, no matter what creed. He loves them. He loves them. He loves them. So if God says choose life, then he's wanting us to choose life. Why would he say, I've said before you, life and death? Do you think he would even say, choose death? No, choose life, that you and your seed may live. Each person has to come to that place, to the realization, say, you know what, I'm not having anything that the devil has. I refuse to receive everything that the devil has. I choose life. And you make that choice. The devil cannot override your will. Neither will God. God will not override your will. Just remember that. God gives man a free choice. As much as he loves you, he will even let you go to hell, because it's your choice. Somebody said, but why didn't God just make us all serve him? Because that's not how he is. He gave you a free choice to choose him, choose life. I love Galatians 3:13. It says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. And verse 29, and if you be Christ, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Well, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. You can go back and you can study what the curse of the law was. It was threefold. The curse of the law was poverty. So poverty is not a blessing from God. There are people in religious circles that took a vow of poverty and felt like they were getting close to God and that they were being holy. But just the same way, riches are not a sign of holiness either, because there's a lot of people in the world that have great riches, but yet they're evil. But just so you know, poverty is not a blessing from heaven. How many will understand that today and say poverty is not a blessing from heaven? Well, Christ has redeemed you from poverty. The Word of God plainly declares that we know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was so very rich, yet for your sakes he became so very poor, that you, through his poverty, might become rich. The word rich there is to be well taken care of in this life. John chapter 10 and verse 10, the thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill and to destroy. But Jesus said, I am come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. And Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. As he was in Bible days, he is today. So that means Christ has redeemed you from poverty. That means you don't have to be poor anymore. You don't have to be po no mo. I come against poverty. I come against the spirit of poverty. I break it off of God's people. You will not plague their life any longer. Christ has redeemed you from poverty. I come against it in the name of Jesus. I break the spirit of poverty. You will see wherever there's a spirit of religion, there's a spirit of poverty. Religion and poverty are like the Siamese twins from hell joined at the hip. No church has proclaimed poverty more than the Catholic Church, but they are the richest church on the planet, and the Vatican Bank has trillions of dollars, and the great cathedrals are lined in gold. What kind of religion preaches poverty to the people but lives in opulence? Let me tell you right now, God's blessing of abundance is for every person, and his goodness is to every person and to all. Somebody said, yeah, but what if God knew that if I got blessed financially that I might not serve him? You know, the Bible has a scripture for you. The Bible says prosperity ruins the fool. So there's a scripture that covers you. I mean, to even come to that place where you would even say, well, what would happen if I got blessed and then I wouldn't serve God? What kind of an individual is that anyway? Why would you want to not serve God once you got blessed? I mean, then I have to ask the question, were you really serving God in the first place? Because when you love him, then nothing that the world has, not fame, not fortune, nothing can take you away from the love of God. Money is just a tool. It is a wonderful servant, but it is a terrible master. You can just see the blessing of heaven coming upon God's people. Look at Abraham. He wasn't even a minister. He was not even a preacher. Abraham was a cattle rancher and a well digger. Isaac and Jacob, look at the blessing of God upon their life. And then you look all down through the years, you see people that were blessed of God. Even King David, how he was blessed of God. And then his son Solomon, who was there was none like him before or even after. You can't imagine the riches of Solomon. So when God said to Solomon, ask me for anything, Solomon never said, give me riches. He said, give me wisdom. God said, because you asked for wisdom, I'll give you everything. And the Queen of Sheba came and she fainted. Listen, I believe that what we saw in the life of Solomon before he went off, when the Queen of Sheba was a type of the world coming to the church, I believe that in this final hour before Jesus comes, that the glorious church will walk in such a level of supernatural provision and with the solution for perplexing problems that the world is facing, whether in the city, whether in the county, whether in the state or the nation, that the world will come to the church to find out what to do. So great will be the blessing of heaven. Why? Why would you say that? Because the scripture that declares that the glory of the latter house shall be greater than the former house. Hallelujah. I don't care what's happening in the economies of the world. Our economy, as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, is not connected to the economy of the world. Our economy is connected to the economy of heaven. Thy will be done on earth as thy will is done in heaven. And heaven is not bankrupt. Heaven is not in an upheaval. Heaven is not promising its citizens, vote for me and there won't be new taxes. There is no lack in the presence of God. There is no lack in the presence of God. If you were fishing and you fished all night and you caught nothing, if Jesus got in your boat, you'd have a net-breaking boat sinking load of fish. If you had to pay your taxes and you didn't know where the money was coming, he would send you fishing and the first fish you caught would have the coin in its mouth to pay the taxes. If you were down to 5 loaves and 2 fish and you had to feed a lot of people for Thanksgiving, you could pray and your food would be multiplied and you'd be able to feed a multitude. When Jesus comes, everything changes. When Jesus comes to your house, everything changes. When Jesus walks in the door, lack and poverty go out the back door. You should make a decision. I will not be poor anymore. I refuse to be poverty stricken anymore. Why? Because in Christ, you're already rich. You just have to tap into another source. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. People wonder, they wonder how we function around the world. They think, I don't understand how that man functions because we tapped into another source. Are you listening to me? When you know that God is your source and your supplier, it's very hard to even believe him if you think he's against you. Do you know how many people I've heard that were in business said, the Lord took everything from me. I had businesses and I had companies and then God humbled me and brought me down to nothing. And you look at them like God's out there humbling them. You know what the Bible says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God and he will lift you up. So probably it was not God humbling them. Their pride brought them low because pride comes before a fall. God does not take a person and then strip them of everything. He takes you from glory to glory. Maybe what they got by ill-gotten gain. So that was the stripping away of it. Because when they were serving the devil, everything they did was through corruption. But now that they're saved, they can't do that anymore. So then obviously they might get stripped of everything. Because you want righteous labors. You don't want unrighteous labors. To get blessed with $250,000 because you did a crack cocaine deal is not the blessing of God on your life. Amen. There's a right way to get blessed, and then there's a wrong way to get blessed. I prayed with a man and led him to the Lord. Listen to this. I led this man to the Lord, and he genuinely got saved. And I said to him, what do you do for business? Now, of course, I was not even ready for what came out of his mouth. He said, I run an escort service. He said, we have a lot of girls all across the state of Texas. He said, you know, I have the numbers that supply and I can arrange the hookups. And he said, you know, it's not, I mean, he tried to make it. He said, look, we don't, you know, want them to have sex or anything, but I can't be responsible for what they do once they hook up kind of thing. So he said, do you think that I could be still in this business? I looked at him and said, sir, you cannot have an escort business anymore. You have to let the girls go free, you know. So then he said, yeah, but it's just like I'm arranging a meeting for lonely people. I said, no. And so it took him about 3 months and he wound the business down and got out the business and he's in something legit now. But Every couple of months, I get a call from him. Thank you for bringing the gospel to me. Thank you for telling me about Jesus, and thank you again for getting me out of the business. I mean, the nicest guy. You would never even dream in 100 million years. But he just was very successful in this business. He was about to go nationwide, you know. But I'll help support the church. No! No, 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 no! I'm not praying for your business. I'm not praying God bless you. How many have come to realize that poverty and lack are a curse? Then know this today, that Christ has redeemed you from the curse. And that maybe this is your first time ever hearing this, but from this day, the spirit of poverty will be broken off of your life. It will never plague you again. As long as you live. Hallelujah. Amen. It always amazes me how people think the church should be just poor. We should just be poor. We should have nothing. That's not God. We're to be fruitful. We're to multiply. John 15 says to bring much fruit. So much fruit from your life will be increase in your home, in your marriage, in your business, and everything that you do. Can you say amen? Amen. And you know what the Bible says? The blessing of the Lord makes one rich, and he adds no sorrow with it. Hallelujah. So poverty is a curse that was paid for at Calvary's cross. The second thing that he redeemed us from, which was the curse, was sickness. Sickness and disease, which you know the world is plagued by sickness and disease, but that was paid for at Calvary's cross by the stripes that Jesus bore for you. The Bible says, by his stripes we were healed. Jesus took upon himself all the sickness of the world. He became sin, which I'll get to the next one, but all of this happened at the same time. You think about when Jesus was born in a manger. That's poverty from where he came from. Then he takes on all the sickness of the world to pay the price so that you don't have to be sick. So don't sign for the package. Stop talking about the fact that the flu's going to go around. I'm probably going to be the first one to get it. Stop signing for the package of sickness and disease. By his stripes you were healed 2,000 years ago. Hallelujah. Somebody said, but Brother Rodney, I mean, if we don't get sick, how are we gonna die? You could get hit by a bus. No. That's not the way to go either. What I'm saying is God wants his people well. Jesus wants you healed. There's not one time that Jesus walked around and said to somebody, be sick, be blind, be deaf, be lame, be crippled, bring me glory. And yet you hear religious circles saying, God gave me arthritis in the right arm to give him glory. Well, why did you pray for it in your left arm to give him more glory then? And then why do you go to the doctor if you believe God put sickness on you? Then why do you go to the doctor to get healed? Because you're going against the will of God trying to get healed. I mean, how dumb can you get and still breathe? Now, God doesn't want you sick. He wants you well. There's not one earthly parent that would want their child to be sick. Not one earthly parent. I mean, if you have a baby, I mean, when that baby's sick, I mean, it's like rips you apart, you know what I mean? The child's not well, it's, you know, can't keep the food down. I mean, it's like terrible. I can't see any human parent that would just be happy to see a child suffer. Well, your heavenly Father doesn't want to see you suffer, and that's why he sent Jesus. That's the character of God. That's the character of God that was manifested for you that by his stripes you were healed. Amen. Amen. Poverty, sickness, and then the next one, spiritual death. What is spiritual death? Spiritual death is separation from God. There are three kinds of death in the Bible. Physical death, separation from your body. Spiritual death, separation from God. Eternal death, when you die physically and you are separated spiritually, you are then dead eternally. That's what happens to people that die without Christ. They will only come back into their body at the judgment day and then to be cast into a lake of fire with the devil and all his angels. That's what's going to happen to them. When he said, depart from me, I never knew you, you work of iniquity. That's what will happen. But guess what? Jesus made a way. The heart of God was extended to a lost and dying world that they don't have to go to devil's hell. That Jesus was cast out of the presence of God to make us welcome there. So in the religious world, they make a big discussion about the semantics of spiritual death. Then people ask me, did Jesus die spiritually? I said, what do you mean by dying spiritually? He became sin. And he was separated from God. You know what that means? That means God turned his back on his own son. And that took place at 3 o'clock in the afternoon when the sky grew dark. It was like God couldn't look. He couldn't look at his son. And Jesus felt it for the first time in eternity past. He cried out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And the Bible says he made his grave with the rich man in his deaths, plural, deaths. He died spiritually, cut off from God. Then he died physically. The same thing happened to Adam. Adam died spiritually in the garden, and then it took him 900 plus years to die physically. Jesus came as the second Adam, and he was cut off from God so that you and I could be reunited to God. He who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He never committed any sin, but he became the sin offering. He became the curse. Cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. And if you be Christ, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So he has redeemed us from spiritual death. He has redeemed us from sickness and disease. And he has redeemed us from poverty and lack. That's the heart of God. That's the character of God revealed in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That's why don't settle for anything less. Don't sign for the package. When a hell express arrives at your house with an overnight package from hell, do not sign for hell express. Do not sign. They say the demons show up, there's a package with your name on it. Send it back to hell from where it came from. I'm not signing for this. We're not signing for it in our house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Psalm 37, 25, David said, I've been young and now I'm old and I've never seen the righteous forsaken or their seed begging for bread. Forsaken means God will never leave you in despair. God will never leave you in trouble. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth. God is looking for men and women that he could show himself strong in their behalf. And when you cry out to him, he found me in Africa as a young boy. If he could find me in Africa, he can find you right here in Hillsborough County or wherever you're watching from today. This is real. Now, in order to be effective in your Christian life, you need to have a revelation of these three things. First of all, who your father is. Who's your daddy? Who's your daddy? There's a lot of people today who don't know who their father is. Now listen, we can't go and change what's happened in the natural. And I'm not talking about knowing your natural father. Some might never know who their natural father was. You see billboards, you know, who's your daddy? You know, come in for DNA kind of thing, whatever. But I'm talking about your spiritual DNA. When you know your Father is God, we've received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba. That's the strongest word in the Greek for the word daddy is Abba. Hallelujah. Abba Father. He is our heavenly Father. He's not sitting there with a big stick waiting to hit us in the head. He's not scowling at us, shouting at us, screaming at us, throwing things at us, locking us in our room, punishing us. No, because a lot of people, because earthly fathers treated them a certain way, they think that their heavenly Father's that way. So they wake up in the morning, things start going wrong. Oh, God's mad at me. No, you got to realize he's not against you, he's for you. Why would he suddenly be mad? What did you do in your sleep? What did you do in your sleep? I mean, what does a father do if a child is naughty? A father corrects the child, disciplines the child. Child goes to sleep, wakes up in the morning. The father doesn't remind the child of what the child did a day ago or 2 days ago when the child was being naughty. That's gone. They already dealt with that. Hey, boy, how you doing? Hey, sweetie, come here. The father's happy. If we're happy to see our children, are you listening to me? How much more is he not happy to see us when we wake up in the morning? The Lord is happy to see you. The Bible says that he dances over us with singing. God is your father, and he loves you, and he's not against you, and he doesn't hate you, and he's not being mean to you. It's sometimes hard for people to grab a hold of. So you got to know who your father is. Then you got to know who you are. You listen to people. Well, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. And they think they're being, you know, so humble. I'm just an old sinner. No, you were an old sinner. You were saved by grace. But now you're not a sinner. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You were a sinner, but you're not now. You don't practice sin as a way of life. There's not one person that loves God that's born again that does sin and enjoys it and that plans it every day. Not one person. So stop identifying with that. Know who you are. You're a child of the Most High God. You're children of the King. Yesterday, you know, I got to spend a bit of time with my three granddaughters, and so I had to drive them home last night, and so we're telling stories to each other in the car. And so Taylor, she's 13, so she makes up this whole story about me being the king and my wife being the queen, and they all princesses and everything. And, you know, they're going on about this whole thing. That's her identity. You know, she might have been joking, but she really feels she's part of a family that's like a royal family. That's my granddaughter. And I didn't say anything to her. I didn't say we're not royalty like that, because we're actually all part of the royal family if you're born again, washed in the blood of Jesus. He has made us to be kings and priests. So we all really are kings, because he's the King of kings. Who's the kings that he's king of? So, you know, I was encouraged, because I thought this kid's got a good, she sees herself in the right way. She doesn't see herself as a pauper. And so, you know, we sit them down, so babies, what do you want for Christmas? And then they all tell us their wishes, you know. And they know their granny and grandpa are going to make something happen. And then certain things we'll talk to the parents about, and they'll say, no, please, not that. Because you've got to run it through the parents as well, because they have to live with that. Do you understand what I'm saying? But, I mean, Taylor's already put in what car she wants when she can drive. She already told me what, and, I mean, she didn't go to her father. She come to me. Because I told her if she didn't kiss any boys till she's 18, I'd get her a car. So, you know, she's calling on it. You know what I mean? She's starting to call on it already. She's not stupid. She remembers those words. I try to tell her to grow a big nose hair out of her nose that will keep the boys away. But she doesn't like that idea. So, you know, when you tell a kid that 5 years old, you tell her that. So now she's 13. She already knows 5 more years I'm going to be driving. She's already making the negotiation for the car. And you know what? I'm going to have to do it because there's nothing I can do. I can't get out of it now. I said it. And the problem is not just any car. Oh, Lord, have mercy. The Lord has to bless me in the next 5 years. Anyway, I find that funny. So, who are you? Who's the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus? The rest of you, you will be by the end of the service. Then who is your enemy? Your enemy is not people. Your enemy is not other people. It's never other people. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. Your enemy is the devil. He hates you. He is your enemy. God is not your enemy. God is your father, and he loves you. And he's a good God. He is a good God. As for God, his way is perfect. Why is this important? Because faith begins where the will of God is known. How can you believe God or trust him when you think he's against you? When you wake up in the morning and the attack is coming against your life, if you think God's attacking you, how can you even pray? How many understand what I'm talking about? But when you know, because remember this, there are two times the devil will attack you. When you're doing something right and you're doing something wrong. So you have to know. You have to know exactly where you stand. And when the enemy comes in against you, you have to stand up and resist the enemy and take authority over the enemy. Don't wait for another service so somebody can pray for you. You begin to exercise your rights and privileges that you have as a child of the Most High God. Amen. And the only way you can know what the will of God is to spend time in his word. Joshua 1:8, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then you shall make your way prosperous and have good success. Psalm 1, blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in its season. His leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Hallelujah. Psalm 37:4, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. John 15:7-8, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. Romans 8:31, what shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? 2 Corinthians 6:18, and I will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. I am a son of Almighty God, the creator of heaven and earth. I'm a child of God. That's my identity. Hallelujah. 1 John 4:4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Psalm 55:16, as for me, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. Psalm 56:9, when I cry unto thee, then shall my enemies turn back. This I know, for God is with me. Psalm 57 and verse 2. I will cry unto the Most High God, unto God that performeth all things for me. Psalm 126 and 3. The Lord hath done great things for us, whereof we are glad. Let me wrap this message up with this today. One thing I know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that the Lord is with me. I might not know a whole bunch of other things, but I know this one thing, the Lord is with me. And I know that everyone I communicate with, if I can get you to know that, that you know that God is with you, that you know the Lord is on your side, that God is not angry with you, that He's pleased with you, that you His child, that He loves you so dearly. When you know this, everything changes. You pray different. You walk different. You see things differently. You see other people differently. Can you say amen? Amen. You begin to feel His love for other people. You begin to feel His mercy for other people, His grace for other people. And when you get excited about it, you want to tell everybody about it, because you know if they can experience the love of the Father, their whole life will change. They'll never be the same again. This is not religion. This is a relationship. It's not religion. You cannot earn this. I can go make myself better to get this. Everything's been done. All I have to do is believe it. I come humbly to receive it. We're not even worthy to even get it. But He's made us worthy. He's pointed the scepter of righteousness at us. So it changes everything. He's come and made His home on the inside of you. He actually lives. He set up residence on the inside of you. You and I are the temple of the living God. And greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. I want you all to confess this together. Say this off me. Say, God is my Father. He loves me. He's on my side. He cares for me. His word strengthens me. His spirit empowers me. He loves me. I want everybody to bow your heads across this place, please. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you've come into this place today, or you're watching in your home by way of television, you gave or never given your life to the Lord. Friend, let me ask you a question. What would happen if today was your last day on the earth? What would happen if you went home and you put your head on your pillow tonight and breathed out your last breath? I want you to know this day that there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun, that you don't have to go to devil's hell, because 2,000 years ago on Calvary's cross, the price was paid and the blood was shed. And you can stand with confidence. Just like I have been able to declare today, you can say the same way, that God is your Father. All you have to do is humble yourself and say, Lord, I need you. And come as you are. You cannot go and better yourself and then bring yourself back to God as presentable. The righteousness of man is as filthy rags. You just humble yourself and He will come, and the blood of Jesus will wash you clean and remove all sin and all guilt and all shame from your life, and you will leave changed and transformed, not by the hand of man, but by the hand of God, because He loves you. All you have to do is believe and say, yes, Lord, I surrender now. He loves you so very much. Secondly, maybe you've come in this place, or you're watching by way of television, and you've never given your life to the Lord. Well, let me say, you've gave your life to the Lord, but you've grown cold. You're not serving God like you should. There was a time in your life when you were on fire for God, but something happened, and now you've got cold. There was a time when you used to pray, when you used to read your Bible, when you used to go to church, but that's gone far from you now. And today you say, I want the Lord to come and take out the stony heart and put in a heart of flesh. I want God to come and do work in me. I don't want to be lukewarm. I don't want to be cold. I don't want to be backslidden. He loves you. And today he forgives you. If you'll come and receive that forgiveness that was purchased for you at Calvary's cross. Maybe as you're sitting here, it's something that's hidden. No one can see. Pride, unforgiveness, bitterness, jealousy, anger, lust, the hidden things. These hidden things are the things that choke the heart of man. These are the things that need to be repented of and say, Lord, I can't have this in my life. Maybe it's not hidden. Maybe it's outward. Maybe it's something people can see and they all remark about it and remind you on the anniversary of the event. And so you feel like God can never use you because of something that transpired in your life. That's a lie. God's a God of a second chance. And today, if you surrender to him and say, Lord, here I am. I'm coming back to my first love. I want to fall in love with Jesus all over again. He loves you so much. Maybe it's not hidden. Maybe it's not outward. Maybe it's a storm that came against your life. A sudden divorce. A bankruptcy. The loss of a loved one. A sudden illness. The betrayal of a close friend. The loss of a job. Something happened that rocked your world. But today you say, I'm coming back. I'm coming back. And then lastly, if you're in this place, you do love the Lord, but the devil's always lying to you, telling you that you're not saved. But today, you want to make sure that you're a child of God. You want to know that you know that you know that you know that you're a child of God. If you're in this place, you fit into any one of these three categories, I'm going to pray with you and for you, right where you are, without any hesitation whatsoever, quickly, put your hand up right now, say, pray for me. Outside in the overflow, in the main sanctuary, hands are going up all across the building. Today's your day. Just put it up high. Today's your day. Today's your day of freedom. You can put your hands down now. I want you to look at me, please, if I can have your attention. If you're in this section here, you did not raise your hand, but you want to be included in the prayer we're going to pray, put your hand up right now and say, include me. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Yes. Anybody else? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? This section, under the overhang, God bless you. This section, didn't raise your hand but want to be included, put your hand up now. This section over there, you didn't raise your hand, want to be included, put your hand up. And then this section, right to the overflow, you didn't raise your hand but want to be included, put your hand up. I want everyone that raised your hand to stand all across the building. Please stand to your feet. Everyone that raised your hand, stand. Everyone that raised your hand, stand to your feet. Today's your day of freedom. Today is your day of liberty. We're going to pray with you and for you. If you're by yourself, I want you to bring your personal belongings and come from where you are and come fill up the altar. Come, we're going to pray. Come now. Today is your day of salvation and freedom. Come now. Come from the overflow. Come from the main floor, the sanctuary. Come. Ushers, just help them as they come. to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Oh, I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Just try to squeeze in just a little bit more, if you can. Make room for everybody, just squeeze a little bit more. Isn't this wonderful here today? Wonderful. Now, I want you to look at me, and the first thing that you have to know today is the love of God to you today. That you cannot earn it, you can't buy it. It's free. All you have to do is surrender. It's about just giving Him your life. Many people in the world are trying to get closer to God, and they do it with all rituals and many religions in the world. But this really, man doesn't have to do anything to get close to God, because God's already done it all by sending Jesus. And if man believes, then it's done. 2,000 years ago, on Calvary's cross, Jesus took our place. And He died for our sin. And so all we're going to do today, we're going to pray one prayer fits all. If you mean business with God today, God means business with you. And just so you know, I've had the privilege of doing this in 51 different countries of the world. From the Arctic Circle with the Inuit, to the Outback with the Aboriginal people, to remote parts of Africa, Central and South America, Asia, Europe. It's the same. It's the same to everyone. God does not change for anyone. It's all the same. He loves you. And so if you believe today, then today you're going to be born again. I want you to close your eyes right now. I want you to raise your right hand to heaven. That's where your help comes from. I want you to pray this after me. Believe it in your heart and say it with your mouth. Say, Father, I come to you. In the precious name of your Son Jesus. Lord, you said in your word, if I confess with my mouth Jesus is my Lord and my Savior, and I believe in my heart that God has raised you from the dead, I will be saved. So, Father, right now, I confess Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. Come into my heart right now. Take out the stony heart. Put in a heart of flesh. Wash me. Cleanse me. Change me. Fill me. Use me. Let me never be the same again. I turn my back on the world. I turn my back on sin. And I follow you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for shedding your blood for me. Thank you that on the third day you rose for me. And thank you that you're coming back again for me. From this day on, I'll never be the same again. I confess Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. He is my Lord and my Savior. And right now, by faith, in the finished work of the cross and by the shed blood of Jesus, I'm born again. I am saved. Thank you, Lord, for saving me now. Now lift your hands and just thank Him right now. Just thank Him right now. Just thank Him right now.
Well, if you prayed that prayer together with me as I was praying with these precious people that have come
and accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, that means you are now a child of God. And I want to encourage you to find a church in your area that believes the whole Bible, that believes in the power of God today, and that Jesus saves, heals, sets free, and delivers, and He is coming very, very soon. And then I'm going to ask you, please go to our website, revival.com, download the soul-winning tools, and then learn how to share your faith with other people. You must go tell other people what you just did. It's not that you keep it private to yourself. Go shout it from the mountaintops and from the rooftops and tell the whole world how wonderful Jesus is. The only way we're going to change America is one heart at a time. Right now, we're going to pray over the prayer requests that have come in, and I'm going to believe God with you for miracles. Many people have called in, as they always do, for healing, financial needs, marital problems, people that are suffering from depression, and we're going to believe God with you for a miracle in your life. So Father, in Jesus' name, we lift up every prayer request that's coming to the ministry, every text, every email, in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus. Touch every life, heal, set free, deliver, restore, renew, and revive, and turn hopeless situations around. And Father, we just thank you for your very presence and your anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit that invades every home watching now and touches every life. And we give you all the glory, we give you all the praise, and all the honor. In Jesus' wonderful name, and everyone said, amen. Well, thank you for watching the program. Go to our website, www.revival.com. Find out about our upcoming meetings. Come and be a part with what the Lord is doing right here at the River Tampa Bay Church Revival Ministries International, world headquarters right here. We have a Bible school, several schools, in fact, and your life is going to be impacted, touched, and changed. We believe in God for another great awakening in America.